Hello, I'm back, and in part 2, we are going to see how we can perform some operations between two sets. When we say operations, you can think of like medical operations where you cut people's bowels apart or something. In math, it means you have two stuff. Let's say you have two numbers, and you can perform some operation to generate a new number. 1 plus 3 equals to 4, simple enough. And you can use the same numbers and use a different operation. In this case, that operation is a multiplication, and then you get a 3. And something you can use what minus to get a new number, which is minus 2, and so on. And since this is the set, and since this is math, then we would expect to be able to use two different sets and do something between them to generate something new. And here we have a new image here, and that looks kind of should be familiar for some of you, but if you haven't seen it before, and this is called a Venn diagram. So this is another way to represent a set, right? So we can represent a set as the standard set notation. Say 1, 3, 5. And that works because we can see some elements inside those sets. But if you want to see if those sets have some overlapping element, or if they are related in some way, then you would use this Venn diagram to illustrate that. So you for each of the sets, you have a circle for it. And the standard diagram for two sets are these overlapping circles. Right, so when you write this way, you can see there are three sections, like the left, the right, and the middle. If you remove the set B, you just see one large blue circle. So that's gonna be the area where the elements of it are lying around or running around, if you think about them as like animals. And the pink part, so it's containing all the elements of B, and since they overlap, that means some elements, if you want to put an element that appears in both A and B at the same time, you will put that element here, and in this case it's number 1, and 1 is inside there. And to complete the diagram, you have to put all the elements as well. So for the set A, we have A1 and 2, and so that means we have to put 2 somewhere here. But since 2 is not in B, and 2 doesn't show up in the pink set, 2 has to be here in the left side. So in this part, you can say that this part is inside the set A, inside blue circle, but not in the pink circle. And so that's those are all elements in the first set. And for B, we have 1, 3, 5. 1 is there. 3 and 5 has to be outside of the blue circle. And so that's it. That's how we can use the Venn diagram to represent sets that may or may not have overlapping elements. And sometimes sometimes you don't have all the elements. For example, let's use a different set. Let's say C and D. Maybe let's say C is 1 and 2. D dog has 1, 2, and 3, for example. Here, where do you put 1? 1 is in C, so it has to be in the blue circle. 1 is in D, so it has to be in the pink circle. That means it has to be in the overlapping part. And when it's done, 2 is also there. We have some space for it. 3 is inside D dot, but not in C, so 3 is there. And so now this is a Venn diagram for C and D, and you can see that there is nothing there, nothing on the left part, and that is it's 5. You don't have to be like precisely exact on that. I just make sure you draw the first two circles first. And if you actually want to be, if you want to represent that, there's another way, which is this way. You can think of them as two circles where one is smaller and one is larger. And so C is inside and D is outside. And now we say that D contains the whole set C, why don't you? It's read somewhere else here. So now it is more clear that the set, there's nothing in the left, right? Everything in C can be found in D as well. Some example would be like if you think about animal. Okay, this, maybe that is a circle for a bird, and then you have a bigger circle for animal. For example, and because all the birds are animals. That's really one way to represent a concept, represent a relationship between two different sets. So that's that. Okay, and once we write this kind of image, then we can talk about each of these sections separately, and also a combination of the sections. So the first operation we can see, if you have two sets A and B, you can curate a new set by using this notation called intersection. And two intersects that has the same meaning as in English. I've seen when two things intersect, and we look at the part that intersects, or that the part that is that overlaps between the two sets. Here that would be represented by this middle part. And if you take a look at the examples on the right that we have here, if you have A and B this way, if you ask me what is A intersects B, the answer would be the middle part, the elements in both A and B. But make sure you write it as a set. It's still a set. It's not just a number one. It's a set that has one element. Because this part, you can still see that, okay, there are some lines here inside, there's some boundary. So that must still be a set. Alright, so that's the intersection. Oh, and for the second example, C intersects B is what's the set of 1 and 2. Yeah, should be simple enough. Well, there is some meme there that you can look at class, the lecture in class to see the clip. The second one is a union, and the union here has the same meaning in English. When you can, then you cannot combine them. But one thing to note that when you combine it, when you combine sets using the union notation, you don't just write all the elements like one after another. You when you look at the set, you include all the other elements, but those elements only appear once in the set. what I mean by that is if you go back and look at this Venn diagram, right, 1, 2, 3, 5, if you are asking for a union B, right now, by definition, right, that is this big bubble set, and so now it is a set of all elements that are in either B and B or both. So you can see there's one, so you write one there. There's two, you write two there. There's three and five, you write three and five there. And that's when we have a union. One thing to know is you can see that one appears both in A and B. Like it seems like there are two copies of one. But here for the union, we don't care about the copy. We only care if each of them is part of this set. We don't double count each of the elements in the set. Has to be unique. Well, now we have it. We have 1, 2, 3, and 5. And for this set, if I see union D, you get a set of, you see 1, 2, and 3. So you just write 1, 2, and 3, and that's done for the set, for the union of these two sets. That's union. And then the third one is a minus. Right? If the union is kind of a plus, because you kind of add them together, right? Then we must have a subtraction. And in set operations, we call it a minus. A minus means it has the same meaning as the minus. You take something out of the set. Like you start with A, and you take something else. But those things are things that are in B. Right, and if you look at this diagram, right, it means you start with A, kind of like you start with A, and then you kind of use eraser to erase everything that's in B. So you erase the part And now you are left with just the left part. The left eclipse. So now that's a minus. It's in elements in A but not in B. Well, actually I have another example here. Let's use that instead. So we have two sets. Let's find these four set operations. Intersection, union, subtraction, and suppression. You may notice something that there are two subtractions here. Because if you look at the first two images for intersection and unions, they are symmetric. If you start with B on the left and A on the right instead, you still get the same regions. Right, but for the set minus, for the subtraction, it matters which one you start with. If you start with A, then you get the left part. If you start with B, then you kind of get the right part. But anyway, let's see if we can find all these four things. So we have 1, 2, 4, 2, 3, 5. So again, let's write some circles. Now we have two circles. Let's take a look at each element. One is in A. So we can see that it is there for sure. Is one in B? No, one is not in B. So one has to be this part. It's in the blue circle, but not pink circle. Next, we have 2. Where does 2 go? It goes there. Because we can see 2 in both sets. And then just repeat with the rest. 3 is only in B. 4 is only in 4 and 5 is only in B. Now, if we finish the Venn diagram for the set A and B. Now, we can use this diagram to find these 4 operations. What is the intersection? It is the middle part, the common part, the part where they overlapped. So it, and since we only see one element, so it's one that one element. But inside a set, it's a set with just one single element. And then if you want to find the union, if you want to ask me what are in these sets, two sets, you will write 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So you don't repeat the 2. If you use this this diagram to find the union, you don't repeat that. Then we find the subtraction. It is easier to think about the left part of the diagram, the part that is in A but not in B. So here is 1 and 4. Yeah, so that's the left part. Before we move on, if you think about subtraction in this case, it's kind of weird, like because we think about the blue. We subtract the B part, the pink part, but we kind of like ignore 3 and 5. Right, we say that okay, we look at those in A, and then we take away some of them. But that has like 3 and 5 too, which we don't care about this subtraction because we only care about the blue region first, the blue circle for the set A. And then once we have a set A, now you look at each element and see. Is it in B? Take it out. Is it in B? Take it out. Okay, so B. For example, let's say I have just the first set is 1 and 2. The second set is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, even though the second set is pretty large, let's say it's C and D. When you find C is a property, you don't get kind of a negative number. Okay, so you only get just one single number in this set, which is 1. So that's the difference between the subtraction for numbers and for sets. And lastly, when we think about the other side, if you start with B and take a minus and take the stuff out, we are only left with the right part. Here's 3 and 5. So that's it. We have found all the set operations for these two sets. Alright, good. Let's move on to... Well, that's more examples, but yeah, let's skip that. If you want to try that, pause it. It is an example where the sets are described as sentences. So The first step is to first transform them into a set notation that lists all the elements. And then once we have that set, when we have those two sets, then we can draw the Venn diagram. Before we can move on to writing or finding this for operations. Okay, that will be one way that I recommend for this class. But actually, like, if you are familiar with the set, you can actually just read the sentences and kind of think about the set at once. So let's say if we just skip that part, and if we want to look at the set A intersects B, right? How do you find A intersects B? This set must be all the numbers that are in A and in B at the same time. So that element has to have this property, which is it has to hold, and it needs to have a reflectional symmetry. Right here, if you read these two sentences, and if you think about it hard enough, you can say that the only two numbers that satisfy these two properties are 0 and 8. Because we can go it by one. Is 0? Does 0 has a hole and have reflectional symmetry? Yes. And then we move on next. Does 1 has a hole and have reflectional symmetry? No. And so on. It's not in this intersection. And then we can move on to all the numbers in the list. And then for the union, similar, but instead we ask for the OR, not AND. Oh, yeah, I should have that. I think that has 4, 6, 8, 9, or something. But yeah, you can complete this on your own. Now let's move on to, that's the last concept of set. Right, when we write sets using the Venn diagram, we have two sets. But if you go back and look at the first image, we actually have a rectangle that surrounds these two circles. And that rectangle has a name U. In this case, the U is the universe, is the space or the set of objects that we consider to be everything. Right, for example, if I want to find something that is not spicy. Right, when you talk about spiciness, you usually think about food or drink or whatever, right? But if you ask you just, you know, to find something not spicy, you could say a chair. A chair is not spicy. Which is correct, but it doesn't seem right. Right, so when before we can talk about anything, it is useful. I mean, it might be obligatory to first specify what is the universe, what is the scope of objects or of things we want to talk about. So if you talk about things that are not spicy, you would first say, okay, let's talk about food. Can you find some food that is not spicy? Now, share is not share is not food, right? So we don't talk about share. So then maybe that's the set of all the spicy food. Right, then the food that are not spicy would be outside that set, but it's still in the food area. Then the food is the universe. You take a scope there, and once we have another box, a big box, now we can talk about outside the box. Because if you don't have a box, you can't talk about outside the box. Like if I ask you to find something that is, again, it's back to here. If I ask you to find something that is not a bird, you could say love, which is correct, but doesn't help, right? So once you specify, let's say you talk about animals, and if I ask you to find something that is not bird, right? if and let's say A is the set. Is the set of our birds. Right, so now you kind of think about not birds. And not birds here would be the area outside this set, but they're still inside the universe. And the notation we use is a complement with a letter C, just like the. I think they use the set notation, but I prefer the letter C because C stands for complement. I write an A with a C on the upper right corner, or with a dash, just a strength, a slightly diagonal line. And that set on those to set the outside of a what is still inside the universe. Oh, and in other words, right, the A complement is the universe minus the set A. The universe needs the whole box, the whole rectangle, minus you take away out the A. And you can get the complement. Oh, I have another one here. Sorry about the pixels. I don't have enough money to buy those pixels. Right here, if you do find a set A, if the universe is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, then in the first case, you would think of it as this. You would have this diagram with 1, 2, 3, and 5. But since we certify the universe, then 4 and 5 has to be somewhere here. And it must be outside the set A, outside the circle. That's in the first set, in the first case. In the second case, if you, here we change, you can see we don't increase, we change the universe to be something different, then the Venn diagram would be different as well. Here we have 1, 2, 3 as before, but the rest of the universe, the things that are outside, are now 8, 9, 10. Okay, so it's important to establish the universe first. And yeah, that's the end of the set. So next we are going to talk about how to, now we start counting stuff.